בבל, שם ישבנו גם בכינו בזוכרנו את ציון. על ערבים בתוכה תלינו כינורותינו, כי שם שלונו שובנו דברי שיר ותול עלינו שמחה. שירו לנו משיר ציון, איך נשיר את שיר השם על עצמת נחב.
Bishut Mirai Verabotai with the permission of Hashem. I hope all of you are okay. The parasha of this week is the parasha of Balak. There is a big connection between the two parashiot. As always, I like to explain to you the connection between each parasha. With the end of the parasha of the previous parasha of last week and the parasha of this week, of course there is a connection. And of course the connection is incredible. The Gemara said give me the homage. The parasha said Zot Chukat HaTorah, and this is the law of the Torah. As all you know, that HaKadosh Baruch Hu give us certain mitzvot that we don't know the reason why. We don't know. And why we don't know? Because HaKadosh Baruch Hu want us Lema'an Le'agdil Torah Le'adera. Because if we know the reason of each mitzvah that we do, so there is nothing to search. We know everything. Imagine a baby in his house never can appreciate what his father and mother do, they are doing for him, because whatever he needs, he gets it. He gets everything free. So never he can appreciate. He will appreciate, you know, when he grows and he has children and he sees how much he suffers with his children, so he will understand what his parents did for him. The Gemara said that we can never say thank you to mama, to our mother. Never. There is no end of the thank you that we have to thank the mother. Why? Why only the mother? Because the most of the education that the child has is from the mother. Especially when the mother she was pregnant by him. And she held the baby for 9 months in her body. Can you imagine? Until she gets the birth of the baby, how much she suffered. So there is no, and how many times the baby hits the mother with his foot, with his legs. So there is no end. There is no end for the thank you that we should thank our parents for all what they did for us, especially the mother. So the Gemara said that HaKadosh Baruch Hu Lema'an Le'agdil Torah Le'adira. The Gemara said, why there is so many mitzvot? Why? So the Gemara said, because if there is only one mitzvah, so when you have no mitzvot to do, so you don't do mitzvot. So Hashem wants you always to do mitzvot, or carry on doing mitzvot. Second reason, as I told you before, because if you understand everything, so there is nothing to understand, there is nothing to appreciate. But when you study Torah, and you understand Torah, it's fabulous. You discover all the time something, all the time. But that's why there is mitzvot that we know the reason why we do them. And there is mitzvot that we don't know why we should do them. We don't know. It's a chok. And this chok of Paraduma, this red coat that we have to do shechita and to burn all the coal and the ashes to give to purify with the ashes people. It's like sand, you know. You burn all the cow, and then you have the sand, the ashes. They keep them, you know. The Kohanim keep them in the bottles, and they distribute them to all the cities of Israel. And anyone who is impure, after when he become pure, they throw a little bit on him. Why? We don't know. Why it should be red, a red cow? We don't know. Why you have to burn it? We don't know. We don't know. It's a hook. And why there is such a hook, this law? So, as I told you before, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu wanted you to know that you don't know nothing. That at least if you know something, this mitzvah, you don't know it. Even Shlomo HaMelech, that he was the master of the intelligence, he was a big intelligent man, he couldn't understand. He could not understand. He could not understand. Why? Because this is something private, secret of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, that there is something that you will not search. Maybe one day, maybe. So the people of Umot HaOlam, the nations at the time, they were laughing at this mitzvah. They were laughing. Why they were laughing? Because they said the same reason, the same that this mitzvah, we don't know the reason about this mitzvah. So all the mitzvot, it's rubbish. Now, it's nonsense. It's nothing. This is the way. But we, as a Jew, we should not, God forbid, even that people laugh at our religion, we should not laugh at our religion. We should carry on doing the mitzvot. So now, there is here, of course, a big connection between this para, excuse me, between this parasha of Chokat, this particular law of Para Aduma, that we don't know the reason why this, the ashes of this Para Aduma, it's purified and pure. We don't know. And the connection with Balak. Balak, he was the king of Moab, and Bil'am, there were two people. Bil'am represents the whole world because he was the prophet for the nations. And the connection is that instead of respecting the Jews that they were in the desert, that they did not search no arm, they did not search to fight them, they respected them, especially because Hashem said to the Jews, never fight Moab and Ammon. So a priori, Moab has nothing to fear from the Jews because they will not fight him. Because when we said to the Jews, don't fight Moab, don't fight Ammon, and don't fight Edom. You should not fight them. There is a reason why we should not fight them. And the Torah said that even though Moshe Rabbeinu, Alav HaShalom, he said to the Bnei Israel, give them laws. And those laws, they were written in the Torah, that Atitaev Adumi, Atasait Edom Ahicha, don't fight Edom because he is your brother, they came from Esav, Esav was the brother of Yaakov. Don't fight Ammon and Moab because they were the nephews of Abraham Avinu, Lot, because they had the children of Lot, and Lot was the nephew of Abraham Avinu. So it's incredible. Don't be good to the Egyptian, because don't forget, you were slaves there, and they received you in their country, and they give you food, even that they were you were slaves there, but at least you become a nation there, so you have to respect them. This is the Torah. This is the Torah. The Torah is the orders of the Torah. Even your enemy, you should not fight your enemy. This is the Torah. So now I understand the connection. Hashem said, look, the mitzvah I give you of Para Aduma, people are going to laugh at this mitzvah. Here we are, a proof that people, they are laughing about our mitzvot, and they don't care about our mitzvot. The connection between Chokat and Balak. You see, Balak, he was the king of Moab, for no reason, he wanted to fight the Jews. For no reason, he called Bilam to curse the Jews. I mean, if really he respected them, why you want to fight them? They were, they had an order from Hashem not to fight you, not to harm you, to respect you. Why you want to fight them? Why you want to harm them? Why you want to curse them? The reason is because they don't care about them, they don't care about their Torah. This is the connection. People will laugh, not because you have the best laws in the world that people respect you. Hashem wants to teach the Jews, the more you respect the laws, and the more you will do laws that people will not understand, you will have problems with them. This is life. Life, that in this world, there is no peace. There is no rest. This is a fight for the Judaism. I mean, you see, don't forget, today, we are in exile today. It's not easy for us to do Torah and Mitzvot. Bemet, it's not easy. It's not easy. You know, it's so difficult. It's so difficult to respect Torah and Mitzvot. It's so difficult because the world today is full of internet, you know, of pleasures. People today, they're working for pleasures. People today, they want all their life, all their thought is to do better than the other one, to the best hotels, the best food, the best cars, the best houses, and a house here, and a house there, and a house there. People have too much materials today. Too much. I was yesterday in Cannes for a wedding. Honest, I feel so bad in the airport. It's very, very hot. You know, people, they were not well dressed, really. I had to close my eyes all the way. You know, I would like just to tell you a small story. When I went to, a few years ago, when I went to Cannes, it was an emergency. Usually, always somebody traveled with me, but the plane was full. There was nowhere, no room, and I had to take that plane. So I said to the man, to my secretary, I fly with this plane. You fly with the next plane. We meet there, and then so we can come back together. So that's what we did. So my tefillah, my prayer to HaKadosh Baruch Hu is that no one will be sitting next to me, or at least a man, because it was the summer, the weather was hot. It was a big, big problem for me that to travel alone. Always, never travel alone. Always somebody's with me. And it happened that Baruch Hashem gave me the first row, the second row, and the middle row was empty. The middle place seat was empty. And I was so happy. It was a miracle. The whole plane was full. People didn't stop arriving. And then, oh, Baruch Hashem, they shut the doors. And they did, that's it. Everybody was ready. I breathe. Baruch Hashem, everything is good. And suddenly, I saw the steward to open the door. What's going on? Maybe they forgot something. Maybe there is a man that's coming. Usually, who's going to come? They will not open the door. When the door is shut, they will not open it. What happened? Why suddenly they opened the door? And suddenly what you see? A woman, a tall woman with a dog in her hand. I said, oi, where she's going to sit? And of course, they showed her the middle seat next to me with the dog. Ribbono shel Olam, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Where am I going to go? There is no way to go. And now it was too late. Even if it was embarrassing to ask her, I want to change this seat. It was impossible. So she came, she sits, and she holds the dog for 1 hour and a half. I pushed myself near the window, to the window. And from time to time, the dog, he started to touch me. You know, it was a hell. Damn it, it was a hell. And she loved the dog, she kissed the dog. And if she wanted to talk to me, I said, I did message that I could not understand French, so I didn't talk. I was looking at the window for 1 hour and a half or 2 hours. Can you imagine? It was terrible. It was hell. And when we arrived, we were the first row. So get up and go. No, she wanted to sit. So she held me again 15 minutes. Then she stand up and she left. You see, it's suffering. Maybe for you it's nothing, but for me it's something. It's not easy to leave this. You know how many people I know, they left their religion because of the internet, because of all what's going on today. People, they cannot understand us. They are laughing. The way we look like, and the way we behave, they don't understand. But this is a hook. To be a Jew, it's a law. It's a law. Not everyone has the zechut to respect this mitzvot. That's what Hashem, He warned us. People will laugh at you. But the more they will laugh at you, you respect them. Don't ask questions. This is the parasha of Chukat. Don't ask questions. There is a Shoah. Don't ask questions why it was a Shoah. There is a reason that we don't know. Don't ask. Of course, it's terrible what happened, the Shoah. You know? Do you think I don't have questions? But always I said, well, the day we see Hashem, I will ask him all kinds of questions. So somebody one day told me, maybe there is no Hashem, maybe you will not see Hashem, so why don't ask the question now? Where were Hashem when the Shoah happened? Why don't ask now? Maybe there is nothing after, so there is nobody to ask to. I told him, do you have a proof? Why should I take a chance? Why I had to destroy what I built all my life because of your question? Why you take a chance? What's going to happen if one day you will see the truth? All the questions that you have, all the doubts that you have today, and all the doubts are based, maybe there is nothing. Maybe there is no answer to ask him. Maybe, and what about if there is? What's going to do? Nothing. It's too late already. Or can you tell him I want to come back? We tell you no. This is the work. Our work is to work ourselves to believe, not to have doubt. And this is the parasha of Chukat. The parasha of Chukat, she wants to teach you not to have doubt on Hashem. Mitzvot that you cannot understand why you have to do them. It's not logical. It's not normal to do them. Why should I do them? Okay, why should you do them? This is the will of Hashem. This is the will of Hashem. Just and of course, it's a work. It's a job. It's a work. Of course, we can do things that it's impossible for us to do only when we do sacrifice about all mitzvot. When we get up in the morning, we pray to Hashem, we don't miss mitzvot. So of course, with this love that we have on HaKadosh Baruch Hu, with the small mitzvot we do, like Kibud Av V'Em, like Shabbat, like mitzvot that we do, those mitzvot could teach us to do the mitzvot that we don't know the reason. But if you want to start to do the mitzvot that there is no reason, and you miss the mitzvot that there is reasons to do them, you don't do them, of course one day you will have doubt on Hashem. You see, my friend, HaKadosh Baruch Hu always give us, he starts with us mitzvot, logical mitzvot, like the Ten Commandments. Most of them are logical mitzvot. But you should do them well. By doing them well, like when the Torah said, you should believe in Hashem, there is only one. It's me, I Anokhi Hashem Elokecha. You should not have idolatry. It's a mitzvah, it's logical mitzvah. Because really, if you think about this mitzvah, it's logical that this world, it couldn't be created on his own. There is somebody, there is a creator, there is Hashem. It's impossible. It's not something that, it's like this coffee. This coffee was not made. I didn't come to the office and I find a coffee. And I will ask my secretary, who made this coffee, will tell me, well, it was made alone. It's impossible. No. It's impossible. This cafe, there is somebody who made me this cafe. It's hot. So my friend, this is Parashat Chukat. Hashem warned you. People will laugh at you. What is the proof? Balak. The next Parashat Chukat, Balak. Balak and Bilam. Those two people who made which they know that the Jews are in the desert, they respect Torah mitzvot. Hashem did for them so many miracles. For 40 years they are eating food from the Shamayim. Hashem saved them from Egypt. Everybody knows about them. And what they wanted to do? They wanted to curse them. They started laughing at them. They started to search all kind of averot, sins that they did, that Hashem would punish them. Why? Why? This is just sin at Hinam, to hit somebody for no reason. What they did to you? This is what Hashem wants to tell you. You see, you will have people who will laugh at your mitzvot to make you depressed for the mitzvot that you do. And there will be people for no reason, they will hate you. For no reason, they will hate you. Like Balak, like Bilam. Not only will make laugh at your religion, but they will laugh at you. They will want to kill you for no reason. This is the price that a Jew has to pay. Unfortunately, this is the price. It's not easy. You know, yesterday when I was in Cannes, Nice for a wedding, and I was coming back to Paris, you cannot imagine. All the people were looking at me. I was in the queue, they are looking. The baby children are walking, they look. I mean, I know. It's the white, it attracts. Okay, it could attract, but when you see people, they laugh at you, they make jokes, they say, they talk, suddenly they look at him, they joke. I mean, it's a funny joke, you know, it's a funny joke. You know, you feel that you are like an animal in the zoo, in the cage, and they are looking at you, I think if they could throw at me bananas, they would do it. This is, we cannot understand. This is the connection between Chukat and the, it's not easy, but I would like to tell that story, a beautiful story. That it was one day, a man, he wanted to buy a chicken. He was a businessman, he was a butcher, he sell chickens. And he wanted to buy chickens, live chickens. And then so he went to the farm, and he asked about, do you have chickens? He said, yes, I have chickens, yes. But he said, that I buy chickens by kilo. We weigh them by kilo. He said, okay. So he went to the farm, and he saw thousands of chickens, and among them, he saw a big black chicken. He saw that it was unusual, this kind of chicken. He wanted to look at him, and he saw in front of him, he saw in front of him that it was an eagle. He saw it was not a chicken, but an eagle. And this eagle, he was behaving like a chicken. He was eating like a chicken. He was walking like a chicken. So he said to the boss, what's this? What this eagle is doing here among the chickens? So he told him, no, it's not an eagle, it's a chicken. For me, it's a chicken. And one day I was walking the street in the country, and I find it. And I find him, he was a small one. And suddenly he become big, but he's a chicken. But he said, this one is an eagle, is the king of the birds. He costs maybe 20 times more expensive than the chicken. He said, well, I don't know how much it costs. For me, it's a chicken. His price is the price of a chicken. If you want him, let's weigh him. And according to his weight, you pay me the chicken price. The man, the businessman, he was so, he had so much pain about this chicken. This chicken that he's this evil that he become a chicken. He told him, it's incredible, you cannot do that. It's something incredible. He said, well, what I can tell you is that I'm going to buy it. Okay, I'll buy it. So he took the chicken, big chicken, the black chicken, and they weighed him. The weight was maybe 100 kilo. Well, it was quite heavy. He paid the price. And he took him. And he was walking, because he couldn't fly. He don't know how to fly. Because, like a chicken. Chicken don't know how to fly. So they went. He climbed a mountain. He went to the top of the mountain. And the man, he said to the eagle, eagle, you know, eagle, you're not a chicken. You are an eagle. You're supposed to fly in the top of the mountains. You're the king of chickens. You're not a chicken. You cannot live with a chicken. I feel so sorry for you. It's not fair for me to leave you there. So now I'm going to make you free. You're going to fly. You're going to go. I'm going to make you free. Your duty is to fly high, and to catch birds, to catch chicken. And your food, it's not les grains. You know, the les grains, you know, wheat. Your food is meat. You are an eagle. So he took him and he threw him in the empty air. And the eagle was shocked. He never fled in his life. And he was fighting with himself. And then he came back to the man. Please, don't throw me again. Get me back to my chickens. This is my belonging. I belong to them. The man told him again. He held him. And he told him, your room, your place is not with the chicken. You are strong. You are an eagle. You can fly high. You can fly very, very high. Your children are going to be only eagles like you, not a chicken. It's impossible. So now it's the last chance I give you. I'm going to throw you. Go. And again, the man, he took him and he threw him in the air. And then the eagle was fighting again. And then he took. Then he managed with the knafaim to fly. And then he went, and he was going around, and he went up, down, and he was flying around the man to tell him, I am an eagle. I am an eagle. Thank you. Thank you very much. And then he fly and he went. We are not chickens. Sometimes we behave like chickens. A chicken, they're weak, very, very weak. We are eagles. HaKadosh Baruch Hu give us kohot, strength to fight the Tzara, to fight all the bad envies, to fight the Gaava, to fight all bad qualities. Each man, he has a little bit of behema. Each man could be like a behemoth. Don't forget, what is the difference between a man and an animal? There is no difference. The only difference is that there is education. That we educate our children to behave well. We educate ourselves to behave well. That's it. And there is laws when we talk. The animals, there is no education. There is no politesse in the animals. There is nothing. An animal is an animal. He lives to die. He lives to eat. He drink. There is no derecheret. This is it's an animal. The only difference between us, it's that we can talk. They cannot talk. And Hashem give us laws to behave like people. Like people. Like people. And if sometimes you behave like an animal, like chicken, sometimes, but we should not forget that we have strength. We have kohot. And this kohot could help us to become a match. You think to respect Shabbat, to respect all those days that we are not allowed to work, it's easy. To respect Nida, it's easy. To wake up in the morning to pray, it's easy. To do tefillot every day, it's easy. To eat only kosher, it's easy. And all the time you have to do tzedakot, you think it's easy? It's very hard. Very, very hard. But Baruch Hashem, Kashrut give us the strength, kohot, kohot, that we can be, Be'ezrat Hashem, we can fight our etzara and do Torah mitzvot. We can, if you want. We can. We can. Hashem, we can fly high, if you want. To respect somebody, to respect a non-Jew, do you think it's easy? Or do you think maybe he doesn't respect me? No, you should respect him. Honest. I would have to tell you something that is not good for me to tell you. One day I was in the toilet, in the plane. When I entered there, it was very dirty. Very, very, very dirty. And bam, it was disgusting. Because the person who was there before, he make a mess there. Really a mess. Now I had a big problem. What's the problem? If I walk out, if there is somebody waiting, he may think I did it. And it's a chilul Hashem, it's no good. He's going to say, all his life he will remember this Jew, what he did in a public toilet. He will talk, and he will not say, he will say the Jews. So what I did? I cleaned everything. I cleaned, it took me 5-10 minutes. I made it, you know, bright. And I went out. And when I went out, there was two people waiting outside. Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem. When they entered there, I'm sure they said, ah, it's clean. Oh, it's clean. But he did not know that I cleaned it for somebody else. You see, even it's dirty, it's not clean. Baruch Hashem, if I love Hashem, if you love Hashem, you have kohot to do them. You have kohot, you have strength to respect. This is Zot Chukat HaTorah. Kashruch Hu, he gives you laws that you don't understand. But on the other hand, Kashruch Hu gives you kohot to respect them, kohot to do them, strength to do them. Especially when you have people, you have like Balak, like Bilak, people like Balak, people like Bil'am, that for no reason they want to kill you, for no reason they want to hate you, they hate your religion, they make a laugh at your religion. Let them laugh, let them joke. You do them. You do Torah mitzvot, you do them. With respect. Not because they don't respect you, you will not respect them. No, you should respect them. You see, in the previous parasha of Korah, I would like just to mention you this parasha of Korah. The parasha of Korah that we learned 2 weeks ago, there the Torah tell us about a story about Korah, which he was a very, 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 very rich man. He was a billionaire. He was a very rich man. And what we don't understand is how a man like Korah, that he was a millionaire, that he was very, very rich, and on the other hand, he was a big tzaddik. Eh! He was a big, big, big tzaddik. He was not something like everybody. No! He was something very, very special. The Torah said, the Gemara said, that he was Menoseh Aaron. He was among those people, among those Leviim, that they hold on their shoulder the arch, the Aaron HaKodesh. When the Jews were in the desert during the 40 years, don't forget, they built the tabernacle, the Mishkan. And this Mishkan was there, the Aaron. The Aaron, that is the symbol of the Torah. The symbol of the Torah. The Aaron, according to the arch, represents the Torah Kedusha. And inside there is the Ten Commandments. There is the tables that Moshe Rabbeinu brought from the Shamaim for the Am Israel. It's amazing. It's so holy, this Aaron HaKodesh. And Korah, it was among the people who hold Aaron HaKodesh. And just to touch Aaron HaKodesh, you should be very, very tzaddik, a big tzaddik. You cannot touch the Aaron HaKodesh if you are not tzaddik. you could die if you touch him. What happened? So if he was among those people who he was a prophet, if he was among those people who heard our Kodesh, that means he was a big tzaddik. On one hand he was a big tzaddik, the other hand he was a rich man, and we saw that he competed with his wealth to remain at tzaddik. Usually people that when they are rich, they forgot about religion, and this man, he did not forget about religion. The Gemara said that he had 300 cows or horses full of keys of his treasures. Can you imagine how many thousands of treasures he had, this man? And he was a big tzaddik. So what happened to him? At the end, he became a revolution. He got revolted against Moshe Rabbeinu, and he fought Moshe Rabbeinu. He talked bad about Moshe Rabbeinu and about Aharon. At the end, he died. He was punished. What happened to him? He was an eagle. He became a chicken. What happened to him? As you said, that each chicken, a chicken is a chicken. A chicken could not be an eagle. So what happened to this man? He was on top of the world. He was among those who hold the Aaron HaKodesh. And he became a chicken. He was an eagle. He became a chicken. He fight Moshe Rabbeinu. What happened to him? He knew that he's going to be punished. What happened to him? You know what do we learn from here? We learn something extraordinary. We learn from the story of Korah that a man, he should always know, because not everybody is poor, not everybody is rich. Kadosh Baruch Hu, he gives. He chooses people that Hashem give them money. But this money is not forever. Kadosh Baruch Hu can switch off. You have to always pray to Hashem that He will not switch you off, that you remain what you are. I know a lot of people that were rich, they become poor. I know a lot of people that were poor, they become rich. Of course, what we should ask Hashem to give us a good parnasa, and not to become rich and then to become poor, it's terrible. It's not a good experience. Last night, I saw a man, he was a billionaire before, and I saw him walking in the street at 2 o'clock. I was so bad for him, because he was very, very rich one day. When I saw him walk in the street, become a poor man, he was walking, I felt bad for him. I would like to be like him. I prefer to be just a normal man. Like Yaakov said, Yaakov Avinu said, please Hashem, give me food to eat and clothes. I don't want to be rich, because it's better that I have what I need. To have more than what you need, and to lose it after, it's terrible. Terrible, terrible, terrible. It's a bad experience. So Hashem, He knows what He's doing. But just one thing you should know, that you cannot remain all your life rich. Unless if you pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Maybe if HaKadosh Baruch Hu love you, maybe you can remain all your life rich. If Hashem may say that you are a good man that he can invest on you. So HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he can, with your tefillot, you should pray always. So, but when Hashem give you the money, don't forget that this money came from Hashem. Don't forget. Most of the people, they forgot that. When they become rich, before they are rich, they are in the synagogue, they put tefillin, they eat kosher, they go to the Torah lecture. When they start making money, become rich, they forgot everything, and then they spend all their life in pleasures. That's no good. That is not the way to say thank you to Hashem. It's not the way. It's not good. You have to be very, very careful. So Korah, he was nothing. He was a slave in the desert. In Egypt. HaKadosh Baruch Hu made him rich. Okay? Korah, even that he became rich, he knew how to maintain his wealth and the Torah. The proof is that he become one of those who were holding the Aaron. But he should remain that all his life. But unfortunately, through his money, he could compete with his money. He could live in one hand. I can be like a king. I can have the most glories through my money. And on the other hand, I have only a small job. Okay, it's a holy job, but it's small. I prefer to work with people. With people. People. I want to do Zikoy Rabim. I don't want to do, a job only between me and Hashem. I want to do a job with the public. It's like, you know, the Gemara said, what's the difference between Abraham and Shem Ve'ever? Shem Ve'ever, they were the rabbis of Abraham. But the Torah don't talk about them. And it's Shem Ve'ever, they were Shem, it was the son of Noah. And it was among the three children that remained alive after the Mabul, when Hashem destroyed the whole world, only Noah and his children remained alive. And Shem was among the three children who remained alive when the whole world was destroyed. And Shem was a big tzaddik, and he teach Torah to Ever, and after they had an yeshiva. And Abraham is Hakli Yaakov, the student Torah, and he is yeshiva. But we don't talk about him at all. We talk only about Abraham, not about Shem. What happened to Shem? And the Midrash said, the difference between Shem and Abraham, it's that Abraham, he didn't hide himself in the yeshiva. When he started to learn Torah, he said to himself, I have to teach Torah to people. I have to teach laws, Hashem's laws, to people. Otherwise people will be idolatry. Otherwise people will kill each other. There'll be no end to the bad things. So, and Shem, what he did, he hid himself in the yeshiva. So, Avraham Avinu, Alav Shalom, he did a big job. As the Baal Shem Tov said, anywhere he went, he said, and od milvado. There is only Hashem. Hashem is great. There is only Hashem. That was Abraham Abinu. And Abraham Abinu teach the world to have the name of Hashem in their mouth. If it was not Abraham Abinu, the name of Hashem was forgotten. People, they were adulatri. They had all kinds of avodah zara. They bent to the moon, to the trees. It was terrible. And Abraham Avinu said, no, the one who created the world is Hashem. So this is the difference between serving Hashem or to serve Hashem through people. You serve Hashem and you teach people to know Hashem. This is what Hashem wants. Hashem wants that every man in the world to be his ambassador. Hashem, he created the man in the world to represent him. Because Hashem is up there. Who is going to represent Hashem? The animals? Can they talk? So who can represent Hashem? People. All people. Not only Jews. All people. They represent Hashem. And the only way to represent Hashem, that you should know that there is Hashem. You have to learn. You need education, and then you will develop your faith in HaKadosh Baruch Hu, in Hashem. So I think Korah, he was among. That's what happened to him. Korah, he wanted to be like Moshe. He wanted to be like Aharon. He wanted to be with the Jews, to be a Kohen Gadol, to be a king, to be between them and HaKadosh Baruch Hu. To be a big mediator, to teach. He didn't want to have a small job. He thought he was something. He has capacity. He has money. He can build yeshivot. He can, with his money, he can do a lot of chesed. He can do a lot of things. He wanted to act like a king. That's what he wanted. I mean, we can see, think it was at the beginning of the Shem Shamayim. He had a good thought. I mean, why? What Arab? I am rich. I represent something, and I am from the Shevet Levi, and I am from the family of Moshe and Aaron, and I am rich, and I represent something. But what do I do? I do only a small job. That's not for me. That's what happened to Korah. But the Korah, the other hand, if I was there, I would say to Korah, Korah, Hashem knows your capacity. Hashem knows, but he gives you that job. That's what Hashem gives you, so you have to accept it. I mean, it's not we're looking for a job. Hashem, he already gives you a job. This is your job. You are working with him. You are among those people who hold Aaron. So don't look for something else. We know you have capacity. You can do maybe more than Moshe Rabbeinu. Maybe you can do more than Aaron. But Hashem chose them to do what they did, what they are doing. And Hashem chose you to do what you're doing. What are you looking for? I mean, that's what happened. I know it ato. That's the big mistake of Korah. That Korah, he thought, because he has capacity, he can build the Jewish people through his method, through his shita. But okay, maybe you could, if there is no Moshe, if there is no Aaron, maybe we follow you. But now that there is Moshe and Aaron, what are you fighting for? It's like today, we are in France, we have a president. So, there is a president. I mean, can you imagine in a bar, in a cafe, you will find a man there, a rich man, very rich man. We start to talk about the president of the state of France, and to say, I want to become president. He is nothing, etc., etc. I mean, are you mad? People voted for him. He's the president. I mean, it's a revolution. I mean, they would take him to the jail because what are you talking about? Okay, if there is no president, you can present yourself to become a president. But there is only one. And there is one, he's entitled to be president for 4 years. So what are you talking about? This is a logical thing that Korah did not think about it. I know it ato. And of course, it was not a bad. It was not a shignan. It was not mad. It was very clever. Korah was hachamaya, and that way he was punished. That way he was punished because he could think before he act. You see, on one hand, HaKadosh Baruch Hu give him a lot of osher, a lot of wealth. And you see, he had the Korah to fight this Osher and to become a small man. Fabulous. But at the end, look what happened to him. The Tzara is very big. The Tzara, when the Tzara see you, that you become a strong man, and the Avodat Hashem, on the service of Hashem, he has millions of ideas how to destroy you, how to make you against Hashem. This is a fight. You might tell me why Hashem is doing that. Well, you see, to receive a good Gan Eden, you need that. The more you fight it, Sarah, the more you show how much you love Hashem. And then your reward there, up there, on Olam Haba, in the paradise, will be fabulous, fantastic. This is your job. This is your job. The more you fight it, Sarah, the more you keep Torah and Mitzvot, the more you do things for Hashem, the reward is very important in Bashamayim. And how I'm going to fight the Sahara, his fire, he's an angel, you have kohot, you have strength, you are not a chicken, you are an eagle, you have kohot. You look, Korah, he was a strong man at the beginning, but at the end he started to become like a chicken. And he couldn't, unfortunately, the strength of the Torah is so big, and the Osher to be rich as well, it's a big Korah to be rich. It's very high. On one hand, I am rich, and to act as I have nothing, because to be a Gadol Hador b'Torah, you must feel that you are nothing. You have always to look up at the sky and think, oh, what I have came from Hashem. I did not invent all this. Not kohi ve'otzim yadi. It's not easy. It's very, very, very high. And very hard. It's a high level to be, on one hand, very rich, and on the other hand, very poor. Rich and a rabbi. It's very hard. But if you are rich and you are a rabbi, that means you are more koah. That means you are an eagle. That with your the koah Torah, you can mantle yourself small. Like Rabbeinu HaKadosh, like the Avot HaKadoshim, like Abraham Yitzhak Yaakov, like my grandfather, Rabbi Chaim Pinto. He could be rich if he wanted. But he preferred to be a normal man. But he prayed for others to be rich. But he prayed for them. I pray for you that when you are rich, you will not forget Hashem. My friend, you see, Korah, at the beginning, it was Lishem Shamayim. He did what he did for Hashem. I want to act, I want to work for the Jews. I want to be a rabbi. I want to teach them Torah. I can. And I have money. I will have the poor people. Okay. Thank you, Korah. But Hashem, He did not choose you. You remain your place. Remain your place. Yeah, but Korah, he said, the job that I have, it's only a small job. Even that is a big job, it's a holy job that I hold the arch. But still, I want every Jew is an arch. I want to approach everyone. I want to hold every Jew. I want to teach Torah to every Jew. Okay? But there is already somebody else. There is already Moshe. There is Aaron. And the way he was acting to call all the big rabbis and to make them against Moshe, it was not good. Nisei Eidak and Sheshem, Kohei Moed, they have titles, those 250 people that they fight Moshe Rabbeinu with Korah, Datan Abiram, and Onvil Ben Pelet. It was not easy. It was very, very hard. It was a very hard fight. Moshe had to face all the big people of his generation. And of course, all of them, they wanted to be like Moshe, like Aaron. All of them, they wanted to enter the history, to become something special for the Jews. But that was not the will of Hashem. You can only be what Hashem wants you to be. Of course, here in Paris, there is a chief rabbi. There, I mean, I will not come and ask, I want to be the chief rabbi. But there is already one that they elected him. Did he not choose you? They chose him. You go to Eretz Israel. I want to be I am a rabbi. I have a white beard. I want to be the chief rabbi of Eretz Israel. I want to be the rabbi of all the Jews. Who are you? If Hashem wants you to be the rabbi of all the Jews, Hashem will do something. But now you want to be the rabbi for all the Jews to fight every Hasidut to be the rabbi of all the Jews. Who are you? Are you mad? Yes, but I can do more than everybody. You can do more there. So do it for yourself. You don't have to fight. If Hashem, Mashiach et Hashem, he will be the one for the whole the Jews. We will not elect him. It's Hashem is going to elect him to be Mashiach. And we bring peace. But if a man will come and will say, I am Mashiach, without the permission of Hashem, no one will accept him. They will fight him. That's what happened to Korah. Kadosh Baruch Hu fight Korah, because there was no one to fight him, so Kadosh Baruch Hu fight Korah. And the end of Korah was terrible. So you see, this is, we have Parashat Hukat in the middle, Korah in the right, and Balak in the left, and Parashat Korah in the middle. Parashat Hukat in the middle. Just to teach us that we should do mitzvot, Torah mitzvot, with no questions. What Hashem wants for us to do, we should do them. Even though that people are laughing at you, you should remain, do them. Even they want, by doing them, they will curse you, just do them with shalom. And don't forget, Torah is, you should, to be, Torah, it's, there is a lot of kohot, a lot of strength in the Torah. The Torah, through the Torah Kedusha, it will help you to become a strong man, not a weak man like a chicken, an eagle. Not one day to be a chicken and one day to be an eagle. No, the Torah could help you to be really a real man of Hashem. Not like Korah, the Adatu. One day they are chickens, they behave like chicken. One day they want to become an eagle, and then they want to become a chicken. No. With the Torah Kedusha, the real Torah, if you study Torah, you respect Torah, and not make joke, laugh at Torah, no gahava, no kinah, no ta'avot, you will become Be'ezrat Hashem, a real man. So I wish all of you bracha v'atzlacha, and God bless you, and I pray for you that Hashem give you a good panasa, and Be'ezrat Hashem should have a good week. From this parasha of Balak, you will learn how much when people laugh at us because we do Torah mitzvot in the street, it could only give us more kova, more strength to be more ben Torah. And I would like just to finish with a small story, a beautiful story that I heard, a beautiful story. And from this story we can learn how much it is the kovah of the tefillah, when the strength of the tefillah. In Israel, was a Jew that his son, he has a bad, you know, he has a cancer. And he went to, the doctors told him, well, we need to give him an aggressive treatment, chemo. But we don't ensure nothing. He could live, he could die, we don't know. But one thing we have to warn you, that the first weeks, he may lose all his hair. And this baby, he was only 5 years old. So the parent decided to tell the child what's going to happen to him. And what he told him, the first question was, Papa, would I lose all my hair? He said, yes. Okay. One night, the parent, they listened to the child crying. He was crying so bad. He was crying. So the parent, they woke up, they went to the room, and they saw the child with sitting on his bed and crying. And they told him, why are you crying? He said, well, I'm crying because I don't care losing all my hair, but my parents, I have to lose them, my parents. And he was crying for his parents. He didn't want to lose them. And between you and me, the parents is not a mitzvah to do them. It's just a minhag, it's a custom to do them, because a lot of rabbis do not have parents. Not have parents. But it's parents, it's a good custom to remind yourself that you are a Jew. I work with my parents around Paris, wherever I go, I'm proud. It's not, like everybody, rabbis, it's good for them to have parents. But if you don't have them, it's nothing. I mean, it's not obligatory, it's not, you don't have to have parents. The most important is not to shave, not to cut here with a knife, here. This is the pear. Here, this place here, we should not touch it with a knife, but we should only have even a little bit. But some rabbis, some Hasidim, some Jews, cousin Jews, that we have peot. So this baby was crying for this peot, and the parents they felt so bad for him, they were crying. Okay, and he said, Be'ezrat Hashem, may Hashem he will do a miracle with me, that I will not lose my parent. So the parents were laughing. When he started the chemo, when he used to do the chemo, he was praying to Hashem, the doctors, they looked at him, they were laughing. They said, oh, he's a baby, let him pray. But look, the miracle happened. He lost all his hair. He became a bald baby. Except the peot did not fail. The doctors in Israel, they couldn't believe it. You see a bald baby with the peot. It's incredible. This is the kuach of the tefillah. This is the kuach of the tefillah. You see, each man, he has the kohot, the strength, from being a chicken to become an eagle. This baby is a baby. Yes, he's a baby. But look, the emunah he has on Hashem. His conviction of an emunah on HaKadosh Baruch Hu. If he has a conviction for the peot, can you imagine how much he'll believe in HaKadosh Baruch Hu? And HaKadosh Baruch Hu, he accepted his tefillot. And when he became a bolt from the Kibo, Hashem wanted to show the whole world this way. Teach yourself, learn from this baby. The impossible, he made it possible. He prayed to Hashem for his peot, and Baruch Hashem, he did lose them. And today, Baruch Hashem, he's healthy. Thanks God. Maybe today he's healthy because of this. Because of this mitzvah, of the Kiddush Hashem, when people, they saw a bald baby with the peot, of course, the questions, what's going on? And the story went in the newspapers, story went from mouth to mouth. Yes, this baby prayed to Hashem, look what happened, wow. And with this zichut, of course, with this zichut, HaKadosh Baruch Hu send him a good health. This is the koah. We have koah to serve HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And we should use this koah all the time. Not to use it when we want. When we are poor. We use the koah of the tefillah. Once we are rich, we forgot HaKadosh Baruch Hu. When we become poor again, we started to pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Now, be always near Hashem, next to Hashem, connect yourself to Hashem. By connecting yourself to Hashem, you get more kohot. It's like the electricity. If you want energy, you connect yourself with the energy. But if there is no connection with the energy, with electricity, there is no electricity. There is no electricity. If we want electricity, we want power to serve Hashem, we want strength to fight the Yitzhara, we need to be connected to the Torah. Only by this, we can get more powerful. So, Rabotai, may Hashem give you, all of you, bracha v'atzlacha mikra ratzon. God bless you.